So today is practically the last day for the TA-ship engagement. We will of course have some meaningful activities on 21st when we discuss setting up of question papers and correcting question papers. But today we are going to see some more examples, and you will have a lab immediately after this, and also the programming test in the afternoon, which will be online test in the lab itself. So the TA should note that the lab has to run in the afternoon. Where are the TAs? Ah. So lab has to run in the afternoon, where whatever is the assignment for the lab in the morning, you will be extending your own programs as a part of the test. So today we continue to deal with more examples. Yesterday we looked at arrays. We'll see multidimensional arrays and some matrix computational example. We'll then look at handling data from text files. So in any data processing where you have numerical values and character string values all mixed up as a part of a record split in various fields, and you will be required to handle those values, including their validations and computations based on those. In fact, your lab assignment is essentially based on this kind of problem today. And finally, we'll discuss the digital images, how they are represented, and that we'll discuss specifically the histogram equalization problem. Any one of you has done a course in image processing or something? Yeah, just a few people. Must have been an elective in your final exam. Okay. But basic image representation and handling is pretty simple and straightforward, so I'll describe that. And that will lead to some discussion on the kind of projects which are given in CS101. So we'll discuss those projects a bit, and then we'll describe the lab assignment today. Multidimensional arrays, again, well known to you, of course. By the way, I hope you have figured out that what I'm explaining is not so much as to explaining to you, but how these things would be explained to first-year students, so that you keep in mind that perspective. Because many of these examples will be actually as is used in this CS101, with of course several more about which you will know from time to time. So effectively, we say that just as we declare a one-dimensional array, we can declare a multidimensional array. And this has 50 rows and 40 columns, but the indices work from 0 to 49 and 0 to 39, and that each element is now accessed by a pair of index expressions. And if it's a three-dimensional array, then a triplet of index expressions, etc. And the rules for index expressions stay exactly the same as they are for single-dimensional array. We then go into handling matrices. Some interesting problems about floating point arithmetic get exemplified when we discuss these computational problems. Here the problem that is being discussed is the representation of a system of equations in multiple variables. So the example here shows two equations, one and two, in two variables y and z, and these can be represented as a coefficient matrix multiplied by the independent variables equal to the right hand side. So typically the Gaussian elimination method which we describe uses two facts from the system of linear equations. One standard fact is that the system of equations is unaffected if an equation is multiplied by a constant. So we take equation number 1 and multiply it by 0.5, so we get equation 1 dash and equation 2. Observe that what we have achieved is a 1 on the diagonal element. The next step of Gaussian elimination usually says, oh, this is merely a representation of equation 1 dash and 2 in terms of coefficient matrix, the independent variables, and the right hand side. So this is the second fact, that if equation is replaced by a linear combination of itself and any other row, the system of equations remains the same. Now these are very well standard things. I suppose they are known to the school level algebra, right? Solving simultaneous equations in algebraic variables is well known. Fine. So that's what we found, at least for the JE entrance, that they all had done this. So we show that we can replace the second equation by subtracting from it a multiple of the first equation, a modified first equation, which is say 4 times this. And this was equation 1 dash, which we multiply by 4 and subtract from equation 2 this multiple. So effectively we are trying to get this as 0 and this 3 as whatever value. So you get 1, 2, 0, minus 5. Notice that we are slowly moving towards an upper triangular matrix in this case. And of course this is minus 5 here, so we can get 1 on the diagonal by further dividing equation 2 dash by minus 5, then we will get this. The advantage of this is indicated to the students by saying that if I have the system of equations in this form, then I can start from the last equation where I directly get the value of z equal to 3, and then I can do a back substitution of z into this. So for example, z is equal to 3, and then I substitute this value 3 into the first equation, and I'll get y plus 6 equal to 4 or y equal to minus. So if I had more equations, I could keep on doing this back substitution and get the result. This I have found, by the way, it also helps people to sort of resurrect their memories of simultaneous equations, because some of them might have done it only partially. Some of them have given it up in what you call matter of choice, because in standard exams you have solve any 6 questions out of 10 kind of stuff. So I don't know what you did, but I used to drop off portions of syllabus in my 3rd year and 4th year and 5th year of engineering. So that would happen any time if you are given a choice. So this also helps them to revise their own notions of simultaneous equations. So we conclude that the essence of this method is to reduce the coefficient matrix to an upper triangular form, which means all elements of the diagonal are 1, and then to use back substitution. Then we point out that this method is susceptible to round off error. Multiplication and division will not cause so much problem, but when you subtract something from something else, for example, when you get a 0, you have to calculate a factor, multiply by that factor an equation, and then subtract or add, whatever. And when you do that, if there are coefficients which are drastically different from each other, you will have a round off error. So floating point errors are very important here. And then we say that there are other variations such as Gauss-Jordan elimination, which also involves pivoting, or LU decomposition. We leave the names here. Those who are interested can go back and refer to, or in subsequent years of their stay in their own respective departments, they will study these things. I think I mentioned this numerical recipes in C, C++, Fortran, etc. So these are the 4 authors. It's an extremely famous book. If you get a chance, do not miss to look it up. Then we describe the general representation. We say a general representation of n variables, linear system in n variables can be represented like this. And then we say that although this is the mathematical notation that we use, since arrays begin their coefficients from 0 and not from 1, we would rather prefer this representation. So this is an artificial replacement of the standard mathematical notation that we use, but it is very easy for people to map it from 1 to n to 0 to n minus 1. And then we say the Gaussian elimination technique will reduce the coefficient matrix to the upper triangular form, which will look like this. And once we get this, we can use back substitution to solve the problem. So in general, a system of n equations can be written as a two-dimensional matrix A multiplied by a one-dimensional matrix X, which is the unknown variables, equal to B, which is the right-hand side matrix. And then we explain using the array notation how the equations will look like. So x0 plus a0 1 into x1 plus a0 2 into x2, etc., etc., equal to b0 and so on. So then we say that if we example equations of the two variables is taken, how will it look like into a matrix representation form? It's very straightforward, and this is shown to be reduced to upper triangular matrix and solution found by back substitution. So with this background, we then go ahead to explain the program which will implement the Gauss elimination. We have this matrix A, matrix B, and X. We define things like divisor, factor, sum, etc., which are obviously temporary variables which are required during the computations. This is just the matrix input, so I read out the two matrices, matrix A and the right hand side matrix B. Then I start with Gauss elimination. So for each row, I divide a row by coefficients on the diagonal. So I calculate a divisor. I set the diagonal element of ith row to 0 because that is what, to 1 because that is what I'm supposed to get. Notice it is useful to do that because if you actually divide, then the division may or may not yield an exact one. Not in this case because you are taking the exact value, but several cases this kind of things would happen. So now you recalculate all coefficients in that row and then normalize the corresponding RHS element because right hand side also has to be taken care of. And finally, you replace the subsequent rows by subtracting portions of the ith equation from it as we saw earlier. And this is the simple program. So for say k equal to I plus 1 to n because we are looking at ith row, so we have to do it for I plus 1th row to n minus 1th row. And these computations are very straightforward. And then we show back substitution starting with last variable. Say xn minus 1 is computed directly. And then for n minus 2 all the way backward to 0th element, we do the summing up of that particular row with values of x which are already determined. So this is exactly back substitution. And finally, we'll get the values of xi. And then we say we output the result. So we output matrix A, we output the matrix B, and we output the values of x. This, of course, takes much longer in a class. But two things I would like you to notice. First is the matrix use in Gauss elimination is not treated as a programming problem. It is treated as a mathematics problem that we are trying to solve. Second, sufficient time is spent in explaining what Gauss elimination is, although most people will know it. Because the framework in which we are putting Gauss elimination is different. It's a two-dimensional array of C++ programming context rather than a plain mathematical notation. So we believe that it is important to do so that the students acquire a fairly good model in their mind of both the programming implementation as well as the Gauss element. Notice also a series of comments which we generally make it mandatory to write to explain various steps of algorithm. It is not uncommon in many engineering colleges to teach programming without insisting on writing comments. Occasionally you will be told to write comments, but as long as you write some documentation accompanying your program, that is considered adequate. As I mentioned earlier, it is not so. External documentation is not a substitute for inline documentation. So both must exist and both have their own role to play. Okay. General useful facilities of the operating system, such as redirection, we discussed it yesterday. I had one or two queries on this, so I thought I will just include these in the slides. I will not spend any time on it, but since all these slides would be available to all of you, I'm just waiting for a common Moodle to be established. I think your LDAP accounts have been activated now. Did you receive a mail? Okay, somebody would have checked today morning because I had sent it late last night that you have not checked. I sent it to MTech 1. The confusion is today officially you are MTech 1, but till last week there was another MTech 1 group. So I don't know who received my mail. If your seniors have received it, they must be wondering why Fatak is asking me to write a C program, but that will be interesting. Did you receive that? No. Okay, good. So it must have reached you. You'll find it in the lab. Anyway, so yesterday what I showed you is that instead of std in and std out, you can use the redirection operator to read the data from this. What is important to emphasize is it will read all input only from the named file. So you can't have some input being read from keyboard and some input being read from that file. Once you say redirect, everything is redirect. So naturally, if you want to give even one value as input from the keyboard, you cannot use redirect. So you have to open the file and handle it that way in your program. Similarly, an output file can be redirected, std out can be redirected to an output file. It shows the input data file coefficients.txt. and it shows the sample results. This I found to be quite useful, and many of my colleagues endorse this. When you discuss a program, it is useful to show the sample output that you will get after running that program. It also forces me as a teacher to actually run the program, because these results are not hypothetical. These are actually screenshots from the actual Ubuntu machine on which the programs are run. So then we can do some massaging to this. For example, here we point out that, look, the values are not decently organized. So you have 0.05 and then 1 here. 1.5 is spaced like this, but 1.4 comes here. Minus 1.08696 comes like this. In short, these 4x4 elements do not appear in any well-organized fashion on the output. So we just point this out and say this is not good. And we would like the results to look something like this. So this is the motivation for formatting. Till this point in the class, no printf is discussed. No scanf is discussed. You will notice a fundamental difference between, let's say, a course where you start with C programming. You have no choice but to discuss scanf and printf right up front. Now that you have done a lot of programming, you would know exactly what those are. But recall the first few days in the lectures. Would you make sense out of printf and scanf? The percent symbols, this, that. As it is, include something is disastrous. Okay. Int main is completely unknown. And to add to the confusion, if you have printf and scanf, it is not very good. Of course, you people, like all students, are smart, so you figure out that even if you don't understand it, the damn thing works. So let us reproduce exactly what is written in the book or given by the teacher, which is a very bad practice. So in order to avoid it, we say don't use any such thing. A simple operator like C in and C out, which is good enough. And that is why indeed we don't call our course by any programming language name. It's a course on computer programming and utilization. And what we use is a combination of C, C++. Incidentally, we do talk about objects, but we don't talk about methods for pretty late in life. We mention classes as natural containers of objects, but nothing beyond that. So we don't teach object-oriented programming for at least half the semester. We teach programming. And we teach basic constructs, we teach basic control structures, we teach arrays and matrices. And you don't need for any of these any mention of any object-oriented programming, because normally a conventional procedural programming is adequate. So that is what is first conveyed there. We have already discussed the DDD for you. For the first year BTEC students, the DDD is described. But more importantly, what they are told is that when you have a long program and if it is misbehaving at portions, you would typically like to include some statements to identify errors. So you print some variables, print something, etc., etc. And these would be called debugging statements. So the useful facility from C or C++ for that matter is that you can have hash if some name and end if. All statements included within this block behave very differently. This XXXX can be any name tag. For example, if I say not sure is a tag. So in my code, if I have if not sure, C out ij, sum ij, end if. Normally, this block will be ignored completely. However, if I compile my program with minus capital D option, giving the name of the tag that I have used, then all the statements will be considered as if they are part of my source code. And they will be put by preprocessor in exact sequence where it occurs. What it means is that when the program is compiled with this option, my program will execute with this cout statement and all such other statements that I have. Once I have confirmed, once I have made changes, once I have corrected things, instead of having to do the ghodagiri of removing all such debugging statements or commenting them, I will just recompile it without minus D option, and again the blocks will be ignored by the compiler. So you would have a clean run of your programs. So ordinarily C compiler ignores the block, but if you compile it with this option, these statements are compiled and are executed as part of the program. So this is about the matrices and some attendant issues, facilities that the operating system has and the compiler has. We'll now look at a programming paradigm which probably only those of you who have worked with Unix would be aware of. And even those people who have used Unix may not have used awk or enawk. Have you?
Yes.
You have used. Okay, good. This is introduced to first year students as an alternate paradigm to solve some problems. So first we'll look at the problems. This was a lab assignment after the mid-sem exam. Mid-semester exam, once it was concluded, it was a 45 mark exam, and the students' marks were collated by teaching assistants such as you, but for their simplicity they put it in spreadsheet. Spreadsheet is much simpler to handle. You can sort it, arrange it, whatever, whatever, exactly the same way as you would do in a database, but you don't require SQL statements to do everything, just enter data. So they collated and compiled everything. Now when they have to give me that entire data, they simply exported it in the comma separated value format. You are familiar with CSV format, we discussed it, I think. Basically, when you take a spreadsheet and say export this spreadsheet as a text file in comma separated format, then this is the kind of records that you will get or lines that you will get. So observe what we have here, 1, 2, 3, 4, it looks like a serial number, 900204009D0701010, these look like roll numbers. Okay. Notice that what happens in a spreadsheet, this number is taken as a numeric value and therefore the first zero is chopped off. Whereas what you have are 8 character roll numbers. Spreadsheet is very bad. If it sees a number, it treats it as a number. So it will remove leading zeros. Consequently, it's a wrong representation of roll number. The next one is name. But in the spreadsheet, if name is blank, you will get 2 commas. So there is no name here. This next one, 0B7A8D, is not known to you. This is what we call a lab batch. So 0ABCD, 1ABCD, 2ABCD, etc. There were 40 lab batches. And the last one, of course, are marks, 44.5, 44, 22.5, etc., etc. What does minus 1 or minus 2 mean? Well, minus 1 and minus 2 was used by my TAs to represent somebody absent. So somebody chose minus 1, somebody chose minus 2 like that. But a negative mark represented somebody is absent. Notice that these artificial design decisions taken by a few people impact the life of all programmers who have to deal with that data. Ordinarily, if you are using a database, then if there are no marks, that is if marks field is null, that means the person's paper has not been evaluated, whether the fellow was absent or not, whatever. Single conclusion. And SQL will work correctly to calculate the averages or whatever, whatever. Not so in text files. So you have to be very careful when you make assumptions or when you take design decisions of this kind. A design decision should be as generic as possible. Nevertheless, this is a good example of simply structured data values for every student, yet made complicated because of these kind of problems here. What we want to do is to find out batch-wise average marks and the class average. So this, on the face of it, appears very simple. This is the batch and these are the marks. So I have 810 students were there last year. So we have 810 students mark, roughly divided into 40 groups. We want to count the total of marks for all students in each group, and then divide it by the number of students who appeared for the exam in that group, and you get the batch-wise total. Seemingly a computationally straightforward problem. But the data is in this form, so how do you handle that? So this is where we say that ordinarily, as C, C++ programmers, you will be using files, reading those files, extracting information from this complex record, which is comma separated, fill those values up in appropriate arrays and then do your computing. But there is a simple paradigm, a scripting paradigm using a programming language called awk. Aho Weinberger and Kernighan wrote this. Kernighan is a familiar name. Kernighan and Ritchie are the creators of C programming language. So they wrote this awk programming language. which makes heavy use of string data types, associative arrays, and regular expressions. Standard stuff in any Unix C kind of environment. You would have heard of a language called Perl. So Perl is a successor of awk, which actually enhances many of the functionalities there. So these are awk language fundamentals. For those of you who have not used awk, it might be interesting to see this. First of all, it's a language for processing text files. So since it is an interpreted language, it doesn't get compiled, you often call it a scripting paradigm. Okay. So you write an awk script, which is an awk program essentially. An input file is treated as a series of records, and each record has a set of fields. So when a text file is read line by line, each line is treated as one record. And then as a line is read, it is broken up into sequence of fields. So you can actually think of a line as first word as for one field, second word as another field, third word as third field, etc. Naturally, if we are talking about some 1, 2, 3, 5, 7 fields, then awk must know when one field ends and another field starts. This is done through a field delimiter. Now, ordinary field delimiter, if you don't specify anything, is either a blank or a tab. But you can specify the field delimiter. So here we specify the field delimiter as comma, which means whenever a comma comes, the next thing is next field, and so on. Pipe is generally the preferred delimiter in Unix environment for most people, for the simple reason that the pipe symbol does not occur in names of human beings, it does not occur in numerical values, does not normally occur anywhere as a valid value. Comma, on the other hand, could occur in, say, for example, an address field. So there could be a comma. But anyway, comma has been a value separator for ages, so that is what we have used here. Now, what does an awk program do? Awk program is nothing but a series of pattern, action statements. So one statement, any statement in awk is a pattern followed by an action. Now, what awk does is that when it starts reading lines, it actually iterates on the lines. So a text has, say, 10,000 lines. It will read first line and apply all the patterns that you have specified in the program to that line. If any pattern matches, or more than one pattern matches, the corresponding actions are taken on that line. Then the next line is read. Patterns are matched. Then the next line is read, etc., etc., till all lines are read and handled like this. In short, it's a record by record processing of input lines, where each line is taken in, patterns are applied, and actions are taken. We shall see what patterns and actions are. Finally, when the file ends, there is no more input available, then there is a special pattern called end, which means that you apply that end pattern only when all records have been processed. So it's like end of the job processing. Like you want to calculate averages and so on, you have accumulated sums. That is where you will use the pattern end, and matching action will be taken. There is also a pattern called begin, which is applied before even the first record is read. This is used for initializing certain things if you wish to, such as input field separator, output field separator. Incidentally, the variables and arrays in awk need not be declared, need not be initialized. The first time you use a variable or an array element, the array gets declared, the array gets initialized, the variable gets declared, the variable gets initialized. That is how the programming becomes so simple here. Let's see some example. So now we analyze this record of the file. So this is a typical record. Now we know the field, serial number, roll number, name, batch code, and marks. What awk does is it creates internal variables to hold values of each field. It separates out the fields as it reads the record and assigns the values to the field variables, which are called $1, $2, $3, $4, as many as they are. So if there are 20 fields in a line, the $20 will be the last one. Okay. $0 refers to the entire record as a string. So automatically when you read a line, it is like scanf or cin, cin $1, $2, $3, etc. It's almost like that. This is done automatically. Now, what do we want to do for every line that we read? First of all, we want to locate the absent students and sort of discard them. We'll maintain a count because they are of no use to us in the average calculation. So what is the pattern? The pattern is that the mark should be negative, which means $5 is less than 0. If $5 is less than 0, we will perhaps increment an absent count. However, for every other record where the marks are positive, we need to calculate the, we need to update not only the total marks for the whole class, but for the batch also we need to update the mark. So for other patterns, increment batch counts, mark totals, etc., and at end, print the accumulated results. This is what, yeah, please.
Does it take care of typecasting?
Sorry?
Does it take care of typecasting?
Does it take care of
typecasting? Yeah.
Oh, very, very good question. As I told you, awk is almost a free-form language. There are no types except string and numeric. Okay. If something is not discernible as numeric, then it is treated as string. There is also a type, a mixed type called string numeric, where you may use some value as a string and also as numeric if it has numeric values. So it appears completely in contrast to the conventional harsh typing that we are familiar with programming languages. So this is not that kind of language at all. Its basic intention is to permit you to do something simply. So there is no hard rules there. If you put hard rules, then you have to write longer lines of code because of the hardness of the rules. So this makes life simple. So three types, numeric, string, and numeric string. And what is decided on the fly based on the value that awk sees. So it decides if the value looks like numeric, it is numeric. Otherwise, it is non-numeric, which is string. Okay. Here is the awk script. The awk program, in this particular case, we do not require a begin pattern, which means nothing needs to be done before the awk starts reading file. So there are exactly two patterns and set of actions. One pattern says $5 less than 0. If that is the pattern, what is the action? Absent count plus plus. Notice no int absent count, no initialization to 0, all that awk does automatic. So the moment you mention the first occurrence or the first use of a variable name, brings it into existence and also initializes it to 0. It initializes it to 0 if it is used later in a numeric sense, as it is with plus plus. It is initialized to a null string if it is used in the context of a string. So the first use determines what the type of that particular variable will be. Okay. The other pattern is $5 greater than equal to 0. That means people have appeared for the exam. Okay. Notice that 0 cannot be an absent indicator because somebody may get 0. Actually, in IIT exams, people can get negative marks. My TAs did not know it. Luckily, in that exam, nobody got negative marks. Or maybe because TAs had decided to use negative values to indicate absenteeism, they did not give any negative marks to students. Anything is possible. But whatever, generally, as I said, you have to be very careful about the design decisions that you make. Now look at these statements, count plus plus. So that means for every record for which you have positive marks, a count will be incremented. This will be the count for the entire class. All the students who have appeared for the exam will get counted by this count. Because these statements are to be executed every time this pattern matches. And this pattern will match every record except for those which represents absent students. Similarly, top marks plus equal to $5. Observe that the syntax is very similar to C, C++. There is no difference whatsoever. In fact, the creators of C programming language created this, so what else do you expect? But notice again that top marks need not be initialized. It is brought into existence, initialized to 0, and subsequent iterations, if there are 820 lines, 820 times this statement will be executed, not 820 times, minus those statements, those records which are negative. So this will be updated. The trick is we want to update now batch-wise totals. We want to maintain batch-wise totals. 0A, 0B, 0C, 0D, 1A, 1B, 1C, 1D, etc., 9A, 9B, 9C, 9D represents 40 batches. Ordinarily, you would have declared an array of 40 elements. And since the 0A, 0B, 0D, etc. are character strings, you cannot use character strings as indices of the array. So you have used indices as 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 and map the 0A to 0, 0B to 1, 0C to 2, etc., etc. Or permits you to use associative array. That means string value can be an index in the array. So when you say batch dot dollar 4 is the batch code. When you first use it, the batch dot array is created. Actually, elements are also extendable. The memory allocation is dynamic. So the first element is created when one value of dollar 4 comes in. Let's say that is batch 1A. So first index will be 1A. And when you say plus equal to $5, that means the marks are added to that array element which has been initialized to 0 automatically when it was brought into existence. So after 4 or 5 records, suppose another student with 0A batch comes, then because I have said $4th element of batch dot, 0A element of batch dot will be updated. This is associative array. So based on the contents, you are actually accessing the array element. So you see how extremely simple life is. In exactly the same fashion, I need a batch count because I need to calculate the batch-wise average marks. I have to calculate the total average and batch-wise average. So you see, I have a total count and total mark count and batch-wise mark count and batch-wise student count. And that's it. That's the complete op program. So when this script runs over all 820 student records, all these counts would have been updated. Of course, at the end, I have to do some work about computing the required results. And that is where I use the end pattern. Remember, I told you when I say end, this is a special pattern. That is matched only when end of file has occurred. That means there is no further record left. And therefore, I can do whatever I want to do here. First, let us look at the last three lines. These are very straightforward. Print total students are count plus absent count. Print number absent is absent count. Print class averages plus marks by count. This is straightforward. These are the counts and we are dividing by it. This one needs some explanation because what I am printing is actually the batch code and the batch average. The batch average is found out by batch dot I divided by batch count I if I am looking at ith element. Similarly, print I will print the value of I. Ordinarily, if I had a numerically indexed array, I would have varied I from 0 to 1 to n minus 1 or some such thing, or 0 to 39 or 0 to 40 or 1 to 40. But this is an associative array where the index is not a numerical value. The index, in fact, is a character string which represents batch count. For that, awk has a special provision called for I in batch. So what this means is that the batch array has been created. We don't know how many elements. As many elements as many batches are there. Now we are asking awk to go over all the actual index values that it has encountered. So I would be 0A, 1B, 2C, 1D, 0B. All unique values because those many elements have been created for that array. And for each of those values, it will print I. So this I is not numeric. This I is actually the index in the batch. So it will print 0A, 1B, whatever. Similarly, the batch count element indexed by 0A or indexed by 1B, etc. will be printed. So you can see the power of the associative arrays. Just try to do this simple thing in C and you will find the kind of matching that you will have to do. At least you have to do a table lookup. Yes.
Does awk deal with this by hashing or something?
We are not discussing the implementation of awk itself.
But internally,
figure it out. You are a computer science student. We are discussing how to use awk. Okay. But that's an interesting question. So people who write compilers or interpreters should worry about that. Right. We will not worry about it here. Yeah. Yeah, we hadn't defined.
We haven't defined batch anywhere.
Oh. There's a mistake here. Okay, so you tell me what is to be done? Yes, for I in batch dot is okay. Because batch count, batch dot, both have the same index values. $4. So any one of these names is okay. There's an error here, you are right. So I can use I in batch count or I in batch dot. That is what I'm printing here. This is the output that the program produces. The way to run the program is to say n awk. Currently, awk is out of fashion. There is a replacement called new awk or n awk. So that's the command you will find on most of the Unix machines. Notice that the syntax of executing n awk is first you say minus capitals for such batches which do not exist. It will be hard to do in C. That is why, in fact, it will be hard anyway. So what you do in conventional data processing cases, whenever you get such data, you run rigorous validation checks first. And you throw out the data which does not meet the validation rules. So how can a student be there who does not have a batch? So you go catch hold of that TA, bash his head, say write his batch code, whatever. Because there are people who are responsible who sometimes make mistakes and these things happen. But awk in the same program will not bother, it will give you these results. So it will produce execution like this. And at the end it will say total students are 819, number absent is 10, class average is this much. You can see the power now. So I do introduce this to describe the file handling and the need for validation, etc. And the natural question that our students have is, if awk is so simple and works so well, why use complicated programming languages? And then we announce the fact that it is superb for such problems, but has limited capability to handle functionality to solve general computation. For example, if you were to do a Gauss elimination or LU decomposition, you would have problems here. Further, it's an interpreted language, which means it is not compiled into the machine instructions, and therefore operationally it will be less efficient. However, for a limited amount of data, such as 50,000, 80,000, 1 lakh rows, etc., awk could be extremely useful. It is, on the modern hardware, it is quite fast and quite adequate. So you use it as a general, as a special purpose tool. If you want to quickly find out something, you can use awk to do this. Of course, as far as our first year BTEC students are concerned, we tell them, get back to our C++. And that is what will be your assignment today. The lab assignment will require you to read the midsemmarks.txt file. So that file, the same file exactly, has been given to you in the zip bundle. And you have to find the class average to sort the data on marks and to produce an honors list of top 10 performers. So in the first part in the lab immediately after this, you don't have to do too much of analysis of various fields, etc., etc. Although if you feel like you can add validations now itself. But essentially your job is to find the class average, to sort the data on marks and to produce the honors list of top 10 performers. So the list you should get in correctly is roll number, name and marks. Okay. Here we are not talking about batch wise performance, etc. But the afternoon test which will be conducted online in the lab itself, you will be required to extend your program. Now I do not know whether you have a common directory because you are all logging in as a single user. So if you do that, you can't store so many programs there. One suggestion is that at the end of the lab, when you mail me the program file, mail it to yourself also. So that in the afternoon, I will mail you the test and you take that test and also from your own copy of the email, download your own program which you can extend. So we use email box as the common repository to be shared between you and me, something of that sort. Is that okay with everybody? Fine. I'm sorry, it's already, okay, 5 minutes, but I'll just take about 10 minutes to describe the last part of a typical CS101 course, which is about the course projects. So here we use digital images as a description. The actual course projects involved handling of fingerprints, but that I'll come to later. So first we explain to them what the digital images are. We tell them about pixel values, for example, that the picture is made of picture elements and number of rows and number of columns determined by the width and height of the photograph, and the digitization sampling rate will decide how many pixels you will have. And then we say each pixel can be represented, if it is a black and white image, by just one bit, 0 and 1. If it is a grayscale image, monotone, that is 0 to 255, where 0 represents black, 255 represents white, and you have all shades of gray in between. That's why you call it a grayscale image. And finally, a full color image, which is represented by 3 bytes per pixel, red, blue, and green. So you have intensity values of red, intensity value of blue, intensity value of green, and the mixture of these intensities will create a color. So effectively, you can have 16 million colors. Incidentally, this is interesting, I don't know whether all of you know this, the capacity of a human eye is limited to a small range from 200 to 2000 colors as far as distinction is concerned. So you're really given 16 million colors, you cannot distinguish two neighboring colors at all by human eyes. But in any picture, you will not have 16 million colors. In fact, you will not have more than 200, 300, 400 colors, and that is why human eye is able to dissect between even neighboring pixels if they are different. But contrast plays an important role in the human recognition of images or digital images. But this is roughly about the digital images. Then we tell them that when we want to store information about images in a file, all that we need is the value of width, value of height, the type of colors present, and value for each pixel. That's all. So images such as black and white fingerprints have small size, 500 by 300. And notice that one bit can represent one pixel, because it is either black or white. Of course, when you capture a fingerprint, you get a grayscale image. That grayscale image has to be converted through some thresholding into a binary image, etc. For large images, of course, compression is mandatory, because you take modern cameras, you have heard of 5 megapixel, 3 megapixel, 8 megapixel cameras. A 12 megapixel camera can produce 36 million bytes per image. 12 megapixel means it has 12 million pixels sensitivity. A single photograph it captures, it can capture 12 million pixels. Each pixel is 3 bytes. So 36 megabytes would be the size of just one image. Even with modern storage available in small form, this would be a very large one. So you need to compress it. And then we tell them that compression can be either lossy or lossless without going into too much details. We just explain that lossless compression means from the compressed form, we can always recover the original image without any loss of information. And lossy means that reverse transformation will not be exact, but we say that the so-called lossy transformation is adequate for most human purposes. And that is why you have formats like JPEG and so on. Incidentally, there are so many formats, RAW, PNG, BMP, TIFF, JIF, JPEG, XMP. Those who have done the courses in image processing, have you seen all these formats? Okay, Wikipedia is an extremely good source of the details of these formats. It's interesting to see how these formats are defined and how they are described in any program and how images can be read, displayed, etc. Anyway, now we come to the brass tacks of programming. So we say that pixel values in digital images can be read in a matrix, a two-dimensional matrix for further processing. And each picture point pixel will have an associated tonal value. Tonal value means intensity, as we said. For grayscale, it will be 0 to 255, 0 represents black, and 255 represents white. And consequently, each element of such an image matrix would contain a value that can be of the type, size, shortened, or cap. One byte is adequate. So consequently, one byte per pixel will require W into H pixels to represent an image, where W is the width and H is the height. Then we describe the notion of a histogram, where we say histogram just tells you how many pixels in an image have the same value. So this is the example that I used last year, a sample image, 8 by 8 pixels. So notice that it's a grayscale image. The center square, which looks like white, is not actually white. You can see it's not pure white. Similarly, the cornermost square is not jet black. So obviously, there is no pixel with value 0, no pixel with value 255. And that is the reason why the contrast of this image is so poor. We can, it's sort of occurring blurry. So these are the pixel values in the sample image. This entire example is from Wikipedia, by the way. So observe that the smallest value is 52 and the largest value is somewhere here 154. And all pixel values are in between. There is only one element with value 52. If you notice 55, there may be another element and so on. And that is what we do when do histogram computing. For any value 52, say for example, how many pixels have 52 as the intensity? Count of that is the histogram value at 52. How many elements have 63 as a value? So it's 1 and 2 maybe. So the histogram at 63 is 2. Like that you calculate the histogram value. So at 52 you have 1 pixel, at 55 you have 3 pixels, 58 you have 2 pixels, 59 3 pixels and so on. Observe that there is no pixel value less than 52, no pixel value greater than 150. Then we define a cumulative distribution function. A cumulative distribution function is nothing but below this pixel, how many total pixels are there below this value. So just going back to the previous slide, if 52 has 1, 55 had 3, 58 had 2, then at or less than 55 there are 4 pixels. At or less than 58 there are 3 plus 2, 5 plus 1, 6 pixels. At or less than 59 there are 6 plus 3, 9 pixels. So that is a cumulative distribution function 1, 4, 6, 9, etc. Okay. What is the importance of a cumulative distribution function? What is the importance of histogram? Well, we then say that one of the reasons why the contrast was not good in that image was because the lowest value was not 0, highest value was not 255. Obviously, if you have the stretched image with all intensities, the contrast would be better. Now, histogram will tell you what is the limit of the distribution of these pixel values. And if you can stretch that, which is called histogram equalization, then hopefully you will get a better contrast. So we then explain the notion of histogram equalization. We show this formula without going into the details of it, and the equalization formula for the example image will work out to be this. And then finally we say, using this histogram equalization, we can map a CDF of 78 is, for example, 46. So what it means is that using that formula, if a pixel value is 78, it should be replaced by 182. So what you find out using a histogram equalization is, given a present pixel value, in the staged histogram, what would be the final value? Obviously, the lowest value should be staged to 0, and the highest value should be staged to 255. But it is not arbitrary staging. So that staging is in consonance with the nature of the image, and that is why the histogram of the image and the distribution function has to be taken into account. So this one, first year students are also able to appreciate, and then you show them the results. So these are the pixel values after histogram equalization. You show them that, you see, you got a 0 here, which was 52 or something, and there is 155 or 154, it has become 255. And all other elements have been stretched accordingly. And then we say that, look, if we had read the pixel values in a two-dimensional matrix, calculated the histogram, done the histogram equalization, and got these pixel values, and redisplayed that image would look like this. And we show this contrast. So this is the original image. You can see the contrast is much better. Of course, here a pixel is very large. An actual pixel will never be like that. You can't, in fact, 8x8 pixel image will be seen as that by human eye. But still, this example is good enough to convey the basic principle. And to consolidate their understanding, I had used another example, again from Wikipedia, which was this. So this is a grayscale picture. Can you discern from the distance, you know, there are some trees, it's like a hilly area, and you can see some trees and so on. Now here, if you look at the histogram, it looks like this. So you can see almost all pixels are concentrated between 100 and 200. And the cumulative distribution function is like this. Now you want to stretch this. So I tell the students that when I stage this, I want it like this. So I want pixel to start from 0 and pixel from 250. Essentially, a histogram equalization will give you a linear histogram cumulative distribution function. That is the objective. So with respect to the original function, how do I stretch it into a straight line? That is what the histogram equalization formula does. And if you apply that, you get this. So just contrast it with the original, and this is what you get. I found last year that this example could actually convince people the usefulness of histogram, histogram equalization, etc. And later on when you add that any Photoshop or any such thing automatically does this histogram equalization easily, then they are able to relate it to actual worthwhile software products which intrinsically contain such simple computations. In fact, modern cameras can do histogram equalization. So you even have a histogram equalizer as an embedded software. Then we tell them how to write a program for this. So we show them the program to calculate histogram. We take an image. We write, of course, comments like this. And then we read out for I equal to, this is a square image that we are assuming. So you take an input pixel and also output an output pixel. After every row, you go to a new line so that you can just confirm the input. Now we set histogram counts to zero. So observe that what we are doing is irrespective of the actual pixel values present in the picture, I need to calculate histogram for all possible values 0, 1, 2, 3, 4 up to 255. So notice what we are doing is we are setting up each element of histogram array to 0, and then we set up a double iteration to go through entire matrix, and all that we do is whatever element we are looking at, whatever is its pixel value, we use that value to index the matrix and update the count. So notice histogram image I comma j plus plus. So image I comma j is the value of the pixel, and that is being used as a index to the histogram. This is another example of associative array. Except that I can do this association in C, C++ programming, because image I comma j is a numerical value. And very happily that value is between 0 to 255. If it was something else, I will have some more complication. It is useful to emphasize the notion of associative array because it keeps coming up in variety of guises at different applications. And then we of course print the histogram. This is just an extension to find the maximum value in the histogram. The maximum value in the histogram, the minimum value and the average is often used as a thresholding for converting a grayscale image into a binary image, etc. Okay. My God, I'll just take 5 more minutes. So I'll just describe the course projects. Generally, a lab batch of about 20 students develop one programming project. As I said, it is not uncommon to have the actual final programming done by them to be in the tune of 500 lines to 5,000 lines. Depends upon how different people do it. It is not just that they are able to write large programs, but they learn an extremely important thing, namely that modern programming is a team activity. No single individual can ever create a million line code system. You require a team. And therefore, what you people have studied in software engineering and other principles, right at the first year, we try to establish these principles in their mind without using the bombastic terms of software engineering. So effectively, each batch is divided into teams, each with 4 members. So if we teach them how to form a hierarchy, each team is led by a team leader. And all the team leaders in that batch form some kind of a coordinating council. And they elect one of them as the sort of batch coordinator. So a leadership is established, a hierarchy is established. Then each problem, each batch has to select a problem from amongst those which are specified. We generally permit batches to suggest the problems also, if they can come up with ideas. And we accept those ideas, provided they amount to the requisite amount of efforts. Typically, the efforts for every course that students take outside the classroom and the lab engagement is about 4 to 6 hours per week. So if you are taking 6 courses, you are expected to spend about 34 hours of your own time in studying for that course in the week, apart from the classes and so on. So we then calculate the person hours that are available for the team. There is a 20 people team, and the project typically runs for 4 to 5 weeks. We know exactly so much effort is required. Now TAs and the teacher are generally able to judge whether the project suggested by them will be adequate or not. And this is another important thing. All projects are necessarily open-ended. That means if required, somebody can extend the functionality of that project to build a 100,000 line code system. That is the openness. So the idea is people should understand that in real life, they are not going to solve the kind of problems that are given in the exams. They are going to solve real life problems, and in a limited time, they may not be able to solve the entire problem. They will be able to solve only a portion of the problem, which is good enough. So the batch then carries out a systematic development activity. Weekly reports are submitted, weekly diaries are submitted, and finally we evaluate them. The projects which were given last year were from the National UID project. So every Indian has to be fingerprinted, and duplicate fingerprints are to be caught so that no duplicate UID, duplicate ID is given. ID must be unique. So essentially of that part we said, since Nandan was busy setting up the whole national framework, the bio, bio standards part, that is what kind of biometrics will you use, okay, I had decided on a fingerprint and iris. So we took the iris and said that you have to capture fingerprints, classify fingerprints and store these, then check for duplicates and then use an application. So typically I provided fingerprint capture devices in the lab. See, every batch will come, they will capture fingerprints of all students once. They will also capture the fingerprints additionally by trying to register that fellow as somebody else. And then another batch will take these fingerprints, classify them and store them. A third team will locate duplicates, if any. So they have to do heavy duplicate matching. I arrange special lectures from outside experts to the first year students on duplicate catching, on the image analysis of fingerprints and so on. So it was actually became a fairly advanced course in image processing for some of the teams. But people did excellent work there. The evaluation was very unique. 25 marks were allotted to the project. So notice 25 marks out of a total 100 marks for the entire course. So projects have a substantial weight in deciding the grade that they will get. 15 marks for project report and 10 marks for self-evaluation. So each student decides, I have worked so much, I deserve 6 marks, I deserve 7 marks, I deserve 10. Nobody ever says I deserve 0. But if I have done nothing and I put myself 5 marks, then there is a peer review process where all the team leaders and the coordinators sit together, all other team members say. And when I say 5 marks, my team leader says, you are sleeping whole of the month, or you have done nothing. So there were cases where 0 marks have been awarded for students by the team through the peer review process. We found this to be an excellent mechanism. I want to increase the marks now of the self-evaluation and peer review to 20 marks out of 100. See, this is something which is peculiar to an IIT system. I can do these kind of innovations. In a university system, if a teacher does that, he'll probably be thrown out of the college or something. Okay, I end this with a sample image of a fingerprint, just to show you that a grayscale image will look like this. There are ridges here. You can see that these are called, you see these breaks? So these are branches. Then there are minutiae points. And it's a very complicated logic, very interesting logic. Those of you who are interested can look at the fingerprint analysis software. There's an open source software, huge system, okay, almost a million line system, developed by NIST, which is a National Institute of Standardization, US Institute, for entire image processing, including duplicate detection, classification based on minutiae, etc. And that is available for anybody to use. So Indian government is also adopting that as the base system on which different people will develop things. So we'll end here. Any questions? Yesterday, I had some time late night to peruse through your assignment submissions. So I was glad to observe that about 79 of you have submitted. I don't know how many are attending, but 79 have submitted. Some efforts are, of course, I could see that you haven't put too much effort. So you're just almost copying the methodology that was given in the sample program. So you are still insisting on reading 17 students, the number should not be more than 17, etc., etc., etc. See, at the MTech level, and this is a signal that I would like to give to you and through you to any students that you coach as TAs later, namely that so far you are used to solving a problem as stated. So the problem says this, or the sample example says up to 17 students, your mindset is 70. But that is not correct. If a sample says an array of 100 elements, you will invariably put in your program an array of 100 elements. Okay. Now that we have discussed a case where there were 820 students, you will grudgingly put an array of 850 or 900. But will you automatically put an array of 10,000 elements, for example? You will not. And that is because you, and like all of us, when I was a student, same thing happened with me. For 5 years, 4 years, I am used to solving problems with exactly stated specification, using examples which have exact statements. And therefore, I have stopped imagining, stopped looking at things in a generalized way. Now that is a message that I want you to adopt first. So look at a problem, but don't go by the problem statement alone. Apply your mind. In real life, what all issues will be there? Think beyond whatever is prescribed, because that is how you will be solving real life problems. So generalize as much as possible, extend as much as possible, and state that with comments. So if you see in a sample program an array of 20 elements, and for some reason you don't agree with it, you should say, I don't agree with this assumption. It is perfectly all right to counter a teacher. This is something which we have not seen in ordinary institutions. Here, the students learn to counter a teacher, to ask questions, to argue, and to prove that, no, mister, you are wrong, I am right. And in the process, sometimes they have to accept that they thought wrongly. Sometimes the teacher has to accept that he has thought wrongly. But what is the net result? Knowledge increases. Thinking increases. So I would like you to do that. I was very pleased to see several efforts, I'm still going through them, which are absolutely excellent. And people have written proper functions for insertion sort, somebody has done a selection sort, there are very good comments written there. So I have a mixed feeling about the assignment submission. Some efforts have been extremely good, but some efforts border on the okay type. So this for your own benefit, it's not, I mean, these are not marks, you are not going to get any grade or something like that. It doesn't count to your cumulative performance index. But I would humbly suggest that for your own sake, okay, use this opportunity to really become absolutely top grade program. You have just one more day to do that. That is why I have put the test, not as a conventional written test, but some squiggles in programming which you have to do on this problem itself that you saw. You have the printout of the assignment. The data file has been mailed to you. If you don't receive that, okay, I will mail it to senior TAs. I have a list of all the orientation program TAs, right? So if I mail to them, even those who are in the lab will get that. So they could then in turn mail it. But MTech 1 at CSE is the correct mailing list now for the first year MTech students? Then what is your mailing list? Oh, you have become MTech 2. But there might be few unfortunate friends from actual MTech 2 who have not yet passed out. So they are thrown into Pavai Lake or what? Or they are concatenated with the new MTech 2. I don't know how the group is handled. You might want to ask the demigods called sysadmins as to what exactly they have done with those few poor people. Because I know one of the students is doing his R&D project, so he's still around. Anyway, that's a separate discussion. Thank you so much. So once again, the schedule remains as it is. Tomorrow there is no engagement in the department because the institute is conducting I suppose they have distributed a schedule for that. Not yet. Very funny. Half of last night I was preparing for my talk tomorrow. If they cancel it, I will have to beat somebody. Anyway, but most probably you will have a session tomorrow from 9 to afternoon, and they will explain the use of Moodle in more details. And day after tomorrow, we'll meet briefly in the morning here. Thank you. Yeah. No, no.